Why is it so difficult to get to Triton, Neptune's largest moon? Triton is the largest natural satellite of the planet Neptune and the seventh largest moon in the entire solar system. This moon is one of the most important bodies for scientific research, as it is believed that it could have an ocean of liquid water beneath its icy surface. However, even though Triton is such an important satellite, only one spacecraft has visited it in history. Then why haven't more efforts been made to visit this natural satellite? Is it tough to get to Triton? Keep watching to find out. Triton has several unique characteristics not found on any other body in the solar system. Some of them are: it is the largest natural satellite in the solar system with a retrograde orbit, which means it orbits in the opposite direction of Neptune's rotation. Large natural satellites, such as Earth's moon or Jupiter's Galilean satellites, usually form with the planet. Because the accretion disk from which planets and natural satellites form rotate in only one direction, a planet's natural satellites gets orbits that coincide with the planet's rotation. The only way a natural satellite has an orbit contrary to the planet's rotation is if it has been captured by gravity. This can be observed on Jupiter. Jupiter has many natural satellites with retrograde orbits, meaning that many of its moons orbit in the opposite direction of Jupiter's rotation. Jupiter's gravitational pull is so great that when asteroids pass close to it, some can sometimes be trapped by the planet's gravity and remain orbiting it, but in a direction opposite to that of its rotation. Satellites with retrograde orbits have been known for a long time, but it was believed that retrograde orbits can only occur on small satellites. The strange thing about Triton is that it is a massive satellite with a diameter of 2,707 kilometers. It has a size that represents 77.94% of the diameter of Earth's moon, and it is the second largest planetary moon about its planet, only surpassed by the Earth-Moon ratio. Being such a massive and large object, it is impossible for it to have formed together with Neptune and acquired a retrograde orbit during its formation. Therefore, the only explanation for Triton's retrograde orbit is that Neptune's gravity captured it at some point in the solar system's history. A dwarf planet? Currently, the most accepted theory is that Triton was a dwarf planet that orbited the Sun in a region very similar to the one that Pluto has today. Still, at some point in the solar system's formation, Neptune's gravity trapped Triton and began to orbit this planet in the opposite direction to its rotation. This idea is supported not only by its retrograde orbit, but also by studies of Triton's composition, which indicate that the materials of which it is formed closely resemble those of Pluto. Like Pluto's, Triton's crust is 55% nitrogen ice, 35% water ice, and 20% frozen carbon dioxide, better known as dry ice. This composition indicates that in the past, Triton was a dwarf planet larger than Pluto, but it became a moon when it became trapped in Neptune's gravitational field. Astronomers' observations indicate that the gravitational interactions between Neptune and Triton are unstable. This means that Triton is slowly approaching Neptune. Triton is currently much closer to Neptune than Earth's moon, and predictions indicate that within 3.6 billion years, Triton will pass within Neptune's Roche limit. This will result in a collision with Neptune's atmosphere or the breakup of Triton, forming a new ring system similar to the one found around Saturn. First and last visit. Triton was discovered by British astronomer William Lassell on October 10, 1846, just 17 days after the discovery of Neptune. This discovery was made because Triton was very bright and reflected a lot of light. The amount of light that Triton reflects is so significant that with telescopes of that time, it was impossible to detect any other objects around Neptune. For this reason, astronomers initially called it the satellite of Neptune, alluding to the fact that Triton was the only satellite of Neptune. This name remained until the discovery of the second moon, Nereid, in 1949. Since its discovery in 1846, astronomers have only been able to determine some basic orbital properties, such as its retrograde orbit. Still, with telescopes of that time, it was impossible to see more details because it was too far from Earth. The first detailed observations of Triton began almost a century later, when new, larger, and more potent telescopes were invented in the large observatories. With these, it was already possible to differentiate more features of this moon, such as some spots. Observations made from Earth allowed astronomers to determine that Triton is an icy satellite composed of large amounts of ice. However, its size was not known. Astronomers used different methods to determine the size of an object, one of which is based on the amount of sunlight that this body reflects. Triton reflects a lot of sunlight, so it was difficult to estimate its exact limits. For many years, Triton was thought to be the biggest natural satellite in the entire solar system, even larger than Titan or Ganymede. Gerard Kuiper made the first attempt to measure Triton's diameter in 1954, calculating it at 3,800 kilometers. Subsequent measurements by other astronomers came up with values ranging from 2,500 to 6,000 kilometers, i.e. a diameter slightly smaller than the Moon at 3,474.2 kilometers, to almost half the diameter of Earth. Hey, before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve them for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. For a long time, information about Triton's correct diameter and many other of its physical characteristics was kept a mystery. But this changed in the 1980s when the Voyager 2 probe managed to fly very close to this distant satellite in August of 1989. The images captured by the Voyager 2 probe provided essential information that helped scientists define the exact diameter of Triton, which is 2,706 kilometers, once and for all. Since Voyager 2, no other spacecraft has been sent to visit this distant frozen world. However, the information provided by the only mission to visit this moon helped us determine Triton's diameter and revealed secrets of this natural satellite that we would never have imagined. One such discovery is that, despite being a moon, Triton has a light and fragile nitrogen atmosphere, and possibly has liquid ocean beneath its icy surface. This has been corroborated thanks to the fact that different geological formations have been observed on the surface of Triton, which suggests that it has internal heat. In addition, cryovolcanism has also been observed. This type of cold volcanism can only be explained if inside Triton, some type of heating could be expelling materials below its surface to the outside in the form of geysers. The presence of geysers in an icy body can only be due to something heating it inside. Usually, this heat can be produced by tidal forces or by a rocky core with materials that radiate a lot of heat, like the Earth's core. In the case of Triton, scientists believe it may be due to both factors combined. But if Triton's interior is warmer than the exterior, is there a chance that the ice on the outside will remain liquid? The answer is yes, because Triton's surface indicates a long history of melting. Models of its interior postulate that Triton differs, like Earth, into a solid core, mantle, and crust. Water, the most abundant volatile element in the solar system, makes up Triton's mantle, which envelops a core of rock and metal. But it's thought that there's enough rock in Triton's interior for radioactive decay to keep a liquid ocean beneath the surface to this day, similar to what's thought to exist beneath the surface of Europa and several other icy outer solar system worlds. This makes Triton one of the most distant bodies in the solar system where liquid water could be present. But if liquid water is beneath Triton's surface, could living beings also exist? We'll only be able to discover this when we send a new space exploration probe to study this further. When will we send the next mission to Triton? It's not easy to visit the frontiers of the solar system. The Voyager 2 probe took 12 long years to reach this natural satellite since it departed Earth on August 12, 1977. The reason it took so long is that to reach the farthest corners of the solar system, spacecraft must travel hundreds of thousands, millions of miles into space. The technology for interplanetary flights of 40 years ago is not much different from what we have today. So traveling such great distances is still extremely difficult, especially when the destination is on the planets farther from the sun. Traveling long distances requires vast amounts of fuel, but space exploration probes don't usually carry much fuel, so that amount limits their acceleration. One way to solve this is to use gravitational assist, a method in which spacecraft accelerate by taking advantage of the gravity of massive bodies such as planets. This maneuver is used for spacecraft to acquire incredible speeds when they pass close to a massive object, such as a planet, the gravity of which accelerates the spacecraft a little. However, this method is problematic because it can only be carried out if the spacecraft encounters a body during its journey. If it encounters nothing during its journey, it will not be able to use this maneuver. For this very reason, the Voyager spacecraft was launched during the 1970s, since at that time a very special planetary alignment occurred that occurs approximately every 175 years. This alignment would allow the spacecraft to take advantage of the gravitational assistance of the four massive planets, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune, allowing a small space probe with little fuel to visit all the outer planets and gain enough momentum to leave the solar system. This alignment occurred in the 70s and is not expected to happen again until 175 years later. For many years, another space exploration probe was not launched to study Triton, since reaching this distant world again would require a new planetary alignment. Without the help of the planetary alignment harnessed to take the Voyager probes, it would take several decades for a spacecraft to reach a natural satellite as far away as Triton. One solution to this problem is for a spacecraft to depart from Earth with much, much more fuel than the Voyager probes had, thus acquiring great acceleration. It could reach a speed similar to that reached by the Voyager probes, and thus reach Triton in just over a decade. However, the travel time is still longer than 10 years, which means that if a spacecraft were to take off from Earth today for Triton, channel members who are 20 years old would have to wait until they turn 32 to see the spacecraft arrive at its destination. Similarly, subscribers to this channel who are 30 today will be 42 when the spacecraft arrives at Triton. As you can imagine, 12 years is a long time, and that's one of the main reasons we haven't sent a probe to this moon again, because any mission would take more than a decade, even if it used a planetary alignment like the one used in the 1970s. In short, as the title of this video says, it is very difficult to get to Triton. However, it's not impossible. Currently, some proposals are being made to revisit this distant and cold world. Planning a space exploration mission for a world so far away that the travel time exceeds a decade is not easy. After all, it requires enormous planning and orbital calculations. But that has not stopped NASA scientists. And for some time now, new ideas have been proposed to revisit Triton. One of those proposals is Neptune Odyssey, a mission concept for a Triton-centric orbiter as a possible central strategic NASA science mission. If the proposal passes all the filters, this mission will be launched in 2033 and reach the Neptune system in 2049. As you've just heard, even with modern technology, it would take more than a decade to reach Triton. How old will you be in 2049? Let us know in the comments. Two lower-cost mission concepts have also been proposed for the New Frontiers program. The first of these proposals is called the Triton Ocean World Surveyor. This mission would be launched in 2031 and reach Triton in 2047. While the second will be called Nautilus, which would launch in August of 2042 and arrive at Triton in April of 2057. Can you imagine that? 2057. How old will you be by then? Let's hope that you're still a fan of our videos, no matter how old you are. Now, we would like to know your opinion. Tell us, when do you think the next mission to Triton will arrive? Let us know your opinion in the comments.